Aesthetic breast surgery. Session 15, tuberous breast. The tuberous breast is a congenital and developmental condition that affects teenager women, either unilateral or bilateral. The condition is broadly characterized by deficiency in the horizontal and vertical dimensions of the breast base, and hypoplasia of the breast parenchyma and skin, abnormal elevations of the inframammary fold, herniation of the breast tissue through the areola accompanied by expansion of the areola. The condition has been described in the literature by different names, tubular breast, snoopy breast, herniated areolar complex, domed nipple, nipple breast, constricted breast, lower bowel hypoplasia, and narrow-based breast. To understand the pathology of tuberous breast, we have to know the embryology of the breast, the development of glandular tissue, and as well the fascial and the ligamentous anatomy of the breast, which was described before in video of session 3. The normal development of the breast yields breast of a normal base with a horizontal and vertical dimensions, and a third dimension, which is the anteroposterior projection, developed by the normal anteroposterior growth of the breast tissue. In case of tuberous breast, there is a congenital lack in the base of the breast with less than normal horizontal and vertical dimensions, as well a limited skin envelope doesn't permit normal growth of the breast tissue in the three dimensions. Rather, it allows only the growth in the anteroposterior dimension. Therefore, the breast develops in a tubular shape rather than a conical shape. However, another important anatomical factor in the development of tuberous breast is the constricted base, which is very important to know and understand. What is constricted base? To understand this, we have to remind you by the normal fascial and ligamentous anatomy of the breast. As we mentioned earlier in session 3, the breast is contained in a fascial envelope, which is the superficial fascia. This superficial fascia is continuous with the superficial abdominal fascia of Camper, and actually it consists of two layers, the superficial layer, which is the outer layer covering the breast parenchyma, and the deep layer, which forms the posterior boundary of the breast parenchyma and lies immediately immediately on the pectoralis major and serratus anterior muscle. The deep layer of the superficial fascia is penetrated by fibrous attachments, the suspensory ligaments of Cooper's, joining the two layers of the superficial fascia and extending to the dermis of the overlying skin and the deep pectoral fascia. In case of tuberous breast deformity, the superficial fascia forms a constricting fibrous ring, extends from the base of the breast to the periphery of the area. This constricting ring of fibrous tissue is denser at the lower part of the breast, and it doesn't allow the developing breast parenchyma to expand during puberty. Histologically, this fibrous ring is composed of dense fibrous tissue made of large amount of collagen and elastic fibers. The second deep layer of the superficial fascia has a strong adherence between the dermis and the deeper muscle layers at the breast periphery, again resulting in a constricting fibrous ring at the glandular base, preventing normal glandular spread and radial expansion. Furthermore, recent study in 2019 by Sholtikov et al., based on a histological study of the parenchymal tissue of tuberous breast, they found evidence of intraglandular fibrosis, which limit the normal growth of glandular tissue. In conclusion, because of this constricting or constriction ring, the developing breast cannot expand in horizontal or vertical dimensions, and because there is no superficial layer of superficial fascia underneath the areola, the breast parenchyma herniates toward the nipple areola complex. So the cardinal clinical presentation of tuberous breast is the breast hypoplasia, in particular the lower pole, hypertrophied areola with herniation of nipple areola complex, and a higher level of inframammary fold. Classification of tuberous breast. The classification aims to specify the anatomical deficiencies and pathological findings that helps in management plan. The Gralu et al. In 1999 modified the original classification of Hamburg et al. In 1996. And they classified the tuberous breast deformity into three types. Type 1 deficiency of the lower medial quadrant. Type 2 deficiency of both lower quadrants. Type 3 deficiency of all four quadrants, resulting in a greatly restricted mammary footprint. However, remember that in all types, there is deficiency of the base of the breast and the limited skin envelope. Despite the similarity in pathogenesis, some literature considers tubular and tuberous breasts distinct deformities that present with different clinical features. Tubular versus tuberous. Tuberous breast is characterized by reduction of both vertical and horizontal diameters. In contrast, tubular breast presents with a long vertical diameter of the upper quadrants, extending downward far beyond the inframammary fold, and a normal or relatively reduced horizontal diameter. The goals of management of tuberous breast is to recreate breast of a normal shape, volume, and symmetry. In the context of the pathology findings in tuberous breast, the goals became primarily expansion of the breast base and breast skin. This is actually the primary goal of management. Then, lowering the inframammary fold, restore the breast volume comparable to the contralateral side in unilateral cases, or operating on both sides, creating symmetry. And finally, reduction of the size of the areola and repair areolar herniation. Being the pathology and the presentation of tuberous breast is very variable, so the management is also very individualized to each case according to type and severity of the deformity and the anatomical deficiencies that need repair. Of course, unilateral cases is different from bilateral. In unilateral cases, achieving symmetry is a big concern. In all circumstances, patient preferences is a big concern. Some patients reject synthetic implants, some reject much scars. Therefore, there are many techniques published in the surgical literature with different views of management. Miller technique aims at increasing the limited skin envelope and breast base, and as well increase the distance of nipple to inframammary fold. The procedure starts by periareolar de-epsilization, through which the enlarged areola is corrected. The inferior portion of the breast is mobilized in the subcutaneous plane. Dissection is extended inferiorly to the inframammary fold, and the glandular parenchyma is detached from the pectoral fascia. The area is moved superiorly, and the breast inferior pole is reshaped, performing a Z-plasty to increase the skin of the inferior pole of the breast to accommodate a breast implant. The next year, Denner and Dowden introduced the thoracoepigastric flap, which was intended mainly for severe cases of tuberous breast. The flap is based medially, supplied by the lateral branches of the superior epigastric artery. The flap is dissected as shown in the picture. The end of the flap is de-epsilized and folded over itself. The folded part of the flap is used to enhance the breast volume and to support the nipple areola complex. Circumareolar reduction of the areola is performed. However, the Z-plasty technique of Maillard and the thoracoepigastric flaps are a good idea to increase the breast base and reconstruct the lower pole of the tuberous breast and increase the skin envelope, especially in type 3 tuberous breast. But they usually end by noticeable scars, which almost need subsequent revisions, and sometimes the patient rejects to have such a scar. Breast expansions. Breast expansions was also a tool in the treatment of tuberous breast. The tissue expands, but is placed through a small inframammary fold, which is designed to be a new inframammary fold. The breast expansion is done by either a biluminal permanent Baker implant or exchangeable traditional expander. When the desired volume is achieved, the expander is replaced by a permanent mammary implant. The idea of tissue expansion is to expand the base of the breast and the skin envelope as to accommodate a permanent mammary implant. However, the two stages of the procedure accounts it is advanced. A bucket technique. In this technique, they treated the chopper's breast through periareolar de-epithelialization, resecting the excess periareolar tissue or excess areola. And then dissection is carried out until the inframammary fold. And then a retroglandular dissection is performed at a plane of the pectoral fascia or suprapectoral fascia, detaching the mammary gland. Then the mammary gland is divided from base, creating a superior flap and the inferior one based superiorly in continuity of the superior flap. Then the distal part of the created inferior flap is advanced and fixed to the inframammary fold. Then after, breast implants can be inserted retroglandular or submuscular to restore volume. Again, the idea of the bucket technique is to lengthen and reconstruct the inferior pole in Chopra's breast. Repair technique uses the same principles of bucket technique, but with an inferior based flap. Again, periareolar de-epithelialization, resecting the excess periareolar tissue. Then divide the mammary gland in half with an incision perpendicular to the pectoralis muscles, starting from lower part of areola, reaching the pectoral fascia. The upper half of the flap contains the areola. In the lower half, he creates an inferior flap. Then this inferior flap is freed from skin, medial lateral attachments, keeping the flap attached at the base to the pectoral fascia. The creation of the inferior based flap accounts for the disruption of the constriction ring in both radial and vertical directions. Then the distal end of the flap is fixed inferiorly to its base, bending or folding over itself using non-absorbable sutures and making it spread over the base. This is an important step, since this will provide breast projection and fill the lower part quadrants. Then implants is inserted either retroglandular or retromuscular with a size determined according to the available skin envelope and desired volume. Final periareolar suture using the round pluck technique of Pinelli. As we see, the technique of repair depends on dividing the constriction band and redistribution or remodeling of glandular tissue. Egil Miotti from Italy in 1996 designed a technique to increase the base of the breast and restore the deficient lower pole of the breast. Through periareolar incision, a dissection is carried out to a new inframammary fold at a lower level, and then a glandular triangular flap based inferiorly is raised and folded to sit deeply in the new inframammary fold by deep suture. Then a mammary implant is inserted. By this way, he could disrupt the constriction ring, increase the base of the breast, and created a new inframammary fold, increase the distance between the nipple and the inframammary fold, and restore the breast volume. Another technique depends on what's called parenchymal scoring. As we mentioned in a recent histological study, confirmed the presence of intraglandular fibrosis along with the peripheral constriction ring at the base. Therefore, Maxwell introduced the technique of parenchymal scoring. Through periareolar approach, the gland is dissected off skin to the inframammary fold, then pre-facial dissection is carried out to deliver the gland. Then it's followed by transverse scoring along the posterior surface of the gland, and then a longitudinal or vertical score to the gland substance. Then after the volume is restored by breast implant. With the advances in fat grafting, lipofilling has become a solution in correction of tuberous breast. Fat grafting is performed in sequential sessions to restore volume deficiency. Actually, of important to know within the procedure of fat grafting by injection cannula, the fibrous constriction bands can be released. Of course, the advantages of lipofilling of the breast is the absence of scars. However, lipofilling needs serial sessions of graft. Besides its disadvantages in terms of cyst formations and calcification. But recently, lipofilling has become a tool to repair a tuberous breast. In conclusion, we have to know that tuberous breast deformity is a challenging problem and it's very distressing to patients. They have it. In dealing with the tuberous breast, you have to know exactly the pathology of the deformity. The fundamentals of management include proper planning, designing a new base and new inframammary fold for the breast, disruption of the fibrous constriction ring at the base of the breast and with the either at the base of the breast and within the substance of the parenchyma to restore the deficient lower pole of the breast and finally restore the breast volume. All these factors should be put in your minds. And again, the management of the tuberous breast is very individualized. It depends on the degree, grade, severity, the pathology, the clinical findings. And thank you.